Live from New York City, it's the Gary Null Show. And now, your host, Gary Null.
Hi, everyone. I'm Gary Null. Today, we're going to talk about the latest on how simply to live a longer life. Then, we're going to play you an audio clip that I think is very inspirational. I don't know the person who did it. I'm assuming that they are millennial because it's very personal how they're referring to what happens when we get so caught up into Facebooking and social media that we forget what a real life should be, what should happen when we can take a moment to ourselves, really relate with people by looking them in the face, and appreciate the time we have on this earth. So I'm going to play that for you today, and then we're going to hear from Dr. Suzanne Humphreys. I want to thank all the people from all over the world who tuned in to my webinar on the subject of deadly deception, looking at the truth of everything about the dangers of vaccines. And now the people in the documentary are being attacked. I'll give you just one example of one attack. All of it occurred within the last 48 hours. But none of these people are backing off. As Suzanne Humphrey says, I'm going to defend the children. It's my responsibility as a medical doctor to do so, no matter what attacks come against her. As all social activists know, no matter what your cause, you will be attacked. The very fact that you're willing to stand up for a cause means that there'll be a counterbalancing group of people who feel that you're wrong. Now, they could have reasonable, non-threatening discussions, but instead they will demonize you. They will slander and lie about you. They will make up things about you that are terrible, all with the idea of trying to, in effect, make you no longer relevant in any conversation. Oh, that person's a quack, or that person's a pseudoscientist. None of which is true, but it works. Look, it got us into a war in Iraq and Afghanistan and in Libya and in Syria and in Vietnam. Yeah, it works all too well. So we're going to hear from her today, and then I'll be taking your calls on some of these topics later on. But we always begin with the latest on health and healing. And we're starting with onions. Now, you've heard me say many times that an onion a day helps keep a stroke away. It does a lot more than that. It thins the blood, yes. And it kills bacteria and viruses, absolutely. And it's great for alkalizing, it is. But also, according to University College London, a type of onion could help fight against antibiotic resistance. And in this case, researchers believe the antibacterial properties extracted from the Persian shallot could increase the effects of existing antibiotic treatment. Now, right now in the world, we have an epidemic of antibiotic resistance. I found a chapter in a book I wrote called Body Pollution way back in 1974. That talked about our overuse of antibiotics in meat and chicken and dairy and in children and how that was weakening our immune system. So when we did become infected, those antibiotics would not necessarily be as effective or not effective at all. Today, we have done far more damage to our immune systems and our microbiota. We're consuming a terrible diet that feeds bad bacteria, but not good. And then we're taking by mouth or in our foods antibiotics. So antibiotic-resistant deaths are by the thousands in the United States. Now, one way you can help yourself is by having this particular shallot and getting the shallots and using them. How would you use the shallot? It's very simple. Cut it thin, thin slices, low heat, some olive oil, and whatever seasonings you like, and sauté it. I like to sauté shallots with oyster mushrooms. How do you prepare an oyster mushroom? I never eat mushrooms in a restaurant for some reason, they never wash them. Well, most of the ones do not wash. They brush them off, as if somehow brushing cleans it up. You know, it doesn't. So instead, I put the oyster mushrooms, and then I spray it with a vegetable and fruit spray. I then agitate it in the water to get all the hidden particulate matter out, rinse it off, and then I press it really hard to press the water out. And then I chop it up into pieces and add it into the skillet, low heat, because, here's an important point, all mushrooms release their biologically active chemicals when they're heated. Very few when they're not. So heating increases the medicinal value of all mushrooms. Also makes them more tasty. So mushrooms and shallots, and then you can add that to any rice, bean dish, anything you want, and it's terrific. So they're saying in here, you can help yourself. Well, there's another way, and this was published in scientific papers, there's another way you can also help yourself prevent, or if you are infected with something, to overcome it. Let me give you what should go into everyone's home as far as a natural medicine cabinet. In there I would have wild oregano oil, colloidal silver, ideally at 500 parts per million, a high dose. A lot of it on the market's 10 milligrams. 500's a lot better. Olive leaf extract, 1,000 milligrams. Bee propolis, manuka honey. And then that would be, and then quercetin, echinacea, astragalus, and Siberian ginseng. That is how you deal with things in a natural way. From San Diego State University. Happiness is not a warm phone, according to a new study exploring the link between young people's life, their sense of satisfaction, and their screen time. In effect, phone addiction makes you unhappy. That's the bottom line. Teens whose eyes are habitually glued to their smartphones are markedly unhappier, according to this study. And on average, they found that teens who spent more time in front of screen devices, playing computer games or using social media and texting and video chatting, were less happy than those teens who invested more time in on-screen activity like sports, reading newspapers, magazines, and face-to-face social interactions. By the way, I think it's great if you encourage the teens in your life to go to something alone, not with friends, and not with a cell phone, no portable laptop, and just go to a museum. If you live in a city, and most cities have multiple museums or cultural centers, just to enjoy it. And now they have, in every one of these, they have headsets. You pick them up when you go in, you pay a small fee, put them on, and then as you walk around and you look at a painting, suddenly the whole history of that painting is given to you. And they also have this for the Museum of Natural History, the Metropolitan Museum of Art, Museum of Modern Art. So it's a real education. And it's wonderful. And by the way, they do the same thing in Europe. And they have multiple languages. So whatever language you need to hear it in, you can. And also, I think it's important to enroll young people into shop. I believe it was an enormous mistake of taking shop and some of these other vocational classes out of schools, as if everything had to be pure academics. Because now all we have, for the most part, is we have teaching to the test, but not to critical thinking, and not to deeper context thinking. So when you're working with your hands and you're learning to do something, I think that's terrific. When I was growing up, and I'm sure the same would apply to most people listening who are baby boomers, as I am, you were encouraged to learn basic skills of life. Because our parents all came out of the Great Depression, where how much you could do for yourself would be directly in alliance with how well you were able to support your family. So you had a background in electricity and masonry and carpentry and woodworking, and you could fix things. Today, anything breaks, you either call for service or you throw it away. And also today they're making many things so inexpensive that it's easier to buy something new, which helps the manufacturer, than it is to fix it. So that creates built-in obsolescence. So it's great for people who are manufacturing and selling. It is not good for the planet with the accumulated leftover debris. So anyhow, let's get kids to spend time, at least some things, themselves. Like going for a walk themselves. Seeing if they could write a poem. Seeing if they could sit and read a chapter in a book. Now, I think that let's say of 80 million more or less people between 0 and 18, let's just take those who are more able to spend some critical time thinking and reading. Let's say it's 30 million. You probably had out of 30 million younger people, probably 10 to 15% who would actually be able to read a chapter focused on that chapter. Let's say it's a 20-page chapter without feeling restless, being distracted, or wanting to do something else. That kind of critical exercise allows us to develop temperance towards our material, where we're going to be patient. We're going to get through it. Interesting, because my publishers wanted me to submit shorter manuscripts. And so I did. I submitted a shorter manuscript. Be Kind to Yourself was short. Baby Boomer's Guide to Getting It Right Second Time Around was short. And then I saw that the sales did not increase. So I wrote the longest book in my life, 1,600-page published book. And it sold 75,000 copies, became a bestseller, for women only. And then I wrote another 1,300-page book, which was the biggest-selling health book for about 5 years in the United States. So there is a market for people who want information. They're not reading it all at once. They're reading it in pieces. In fact, I remember Lou Anne Panessi said that she called me once and she said, I just want to let you know I'm sitting here in my bed, sitting up, and I'm reading a chapter from Living in the Moment, Prescription for the Soul, and I read one chapter a night before I go to sleep. And so there were 22 or 23 chapters in that book. All right. And then she said, I read it again because each time I read it is so dense with information, it takes me a couple times to get everything out of it. So there are a lot of people in our society who want to have their mind be honed to more capable critical thinking. And to do that, there has to be a certain discipline. Many, but not all, of today's youth are not disciplined. And we can thank the parents of those kids who are, and some who are just motivated on their own, even if their parents were not encouraging, to take the step back to some of the virtues of the past, where you would read more, you would analyze, you would debate, you would have discussions, you would challenge yourself. One of the best things in the world to do is, after you think you've figured something else, disprove yourself. Or ask others to try to disprove your issue and see what you come up with. So that was this whole study. So a lot of people are unhappy. And it's easy to understand how you'd be unhappy. This was published in the journal Emotion. Because everything it's like trying to understand the character of each drop of water in a shower. You're getting hit with hundreds of thousands of beads of water. It's just inundation. And today, information is inundated every day. So it loses its meaning. It loses its significance. There is no context to it. It's just overstimulation. And that's the information that most people are communicating every day. Also, from the Fresh Toast, they're looking at medical students who did not get an education in the endocannabinoid system, which is unfortunate. most doctors have a firm understanding about the pharmacologicals and other traditional Western medical therapies. That's what they practice. That's their specialty. That's where all the attention, not to nutrition, not to exercise, body, mind, medicine, psychoneuroimmunology, no. Pharmacology, that's all of it. That's unfortunate. But then they're not looking at the cannabinoids, and they should be. We're consuming cannabis for medicinal or recreation or spiritual or wellness or any other purpose. It's vitally important to share this information with your doctor. Now, while cannabis is a safe drug, you need to be careful when you mix these drugs with marijuana. So understand that where 8 states have already legalized recreational marijuana and 29 states allow some form of medicinal use, and that's important. Boy, if we only opened it up to the American public of how much the scientific literature has on reversing and helping with stroke, with seizures, autism, brain cancer, lung cancer, a whole lot of good scientific material. 22,000 studies from the peer reviewed literature is on the Library of Medicine's website. In any case, marijuana, the type that you smoke, quote, this is from Dr. Sarah Melton, the associate professor of pharmacy practice at the Gatton College of Pharmacy, East Texas State University. Quote, marijuana has potentially serious drug interactions with prescription and over-the-counter medications. By sharing details of marijuana use, the prescriber can best make decisions about medication changes and educate the patient about any potential contraindications or need for monitoring. And then the Mayo Clinic took a look at the cannabis adverse reactions, and they are, you shouldn't be smoking marijuana or taking the cannabis if you are taking anabolic steroids. That's a whole lot of athletes. Barbiturates, the benzodiazepines, the central nervous system depressants, corticosteroids, dopamine antagonists, nicotine, meaning smoking cigarettes, yes, and then smoking marijuana, really bad. Non-steroidal anti-inflammatories, there's a whole group of pain people, so frequently people would take a non-steroidal anti-inflammatory and then smoke, not good. Pain relievers and phytoestrogens. So that's important. I just want to share that with you, that you could end up with lots of serious side effects, such as respiratory distress, going into a coma, even dying. You heard me right. Death is one of the side effects from many of these. And it depends upon which one you're using. But dropping your blood sugar really low, dropping your blood pressure really low, shallow breathing, confusion, impaired thinking and judgment, motor coordination loss. And there's, if you look up there, it's a whole lot of bad that can happen. I don't want to see anyone hurt. University of Wisconsin-Madison says that cancer patients who tell their life story find more peace and less depression. That may be true. I disagree with the concept, not individual practice, because some people simply relegate that they're going to die or that it's going to be a long, slow process to which they have told everyone their story, and now they simply have taken a ticket, are waiting to be punched out. I believe if you're going to tell a story, and you have cancer, tell the story of how you have morphed into a living incarnation of the warrior healer. How you're going not just to fight, but you're going to heal this process and of cancer, and all the ways you're going to do it. The type of protocol you're on, the mindset you have, the support system you're putting around you. Because that shows hope. It shows optimism. It shows that you're engaging and liberating your innate natural healing capacity. And that's terrific. So, just another way of looking at that problem. I'm Gary Null, on location broadcasting. We're going to take a brief break and come back, and we're going to go right into an audio clip from a millennial about, and it's entitled, Delete Facebook. Please stay with us.
How many friends you have on Facebook, the fact is we are very lucky to have a handful of real friends in our lives. Having more superficial electronic contact with others does not improve our lives. If anything, it detracts from it, as life becomes less human. LOL pales in comparison to the real laugh out loud of sharing an experience with a friend. The more LOLs we share, the less it means. Sooner or later, everything is just an electronic dance of acronyms trying to fulfill some missing part of your soul. When consumerism was first sold to the world, it was designed to get us to buy stuff we don't need in an effort to feel better than others. Soon, everyone determined their worth not by the strength of our relationships, but by what we were able to consume. You give up relationships to work more, to have a better life. The more we worked, the more we bought, the further in debt we went. The combination of work and debt made our relationships worse, which compelled us to work more and buy more. This self-fulfilling loop spun out of control in our society for decades as people worked harder and harder to look or feel good. Consumerism was a psychological process led by Edward Bernays, Sigmund Freud's nephew, to keep post-World War II industries humming after the war. Industrialists employed Madison Avenue to transform society from sensible people with strong relationships into superficial spenders looking for the next high. Advertising links our subconscious desires with products. Take the cigarette, for example. Subconsciously, it is a form of power and rebellion. The reality is, it is a weakness. Soon we began to buy products not for the utility of the product, but to say to the world, I bought this, and the ad says that I'm cool.
And while everyone you know may own the fanciest clothes
and the best cars, you will own the companies that sell them.
If you want to know what heaven really is, Murray,
try being God.
The bankers that backed all this up needed this spending to create more debt in order for their Keynesian Ponzi scheme not to collapse. This plan worked well for many decades, but as the boomers age, the party is over for consumerism and the check is due. What is the next thing if people are broke? How could they keep the masses from waking up to the wasted lives they had led chasing after nothing? The answer is, let them amuse themselves to death. Facebook is the ultimate expression of narcissism. Where else can you go and expose everything about yourself like a prancing peacock? I mean, you get your 15 minutes of fame every minute. Facebook is, when you boil it down, one big look-at-me fest. Look at my pictures, look at my car, look at where I am, look at my wife, look at my life. The ultimate irony in the social network is that nobody really cares, because it's not about them. Oh sure, they'll say nice things, but deep down they don't care at all. The narcissism is so rampant in our society that people would step over a real relationship to update their status. The answer to the question, what's on my mind, is usually nothing at all. Facebook is also full of shameless promotion. The stuff that isn't vapid on Facebook is probably promotional. Corporations, promoters, stars, small businessmen are either promoting their services or networking to get ahead. There are whole marketing courses about social media managers. The sad thing is that the comments and tweets are not even done by the people you are following. They have social media managers for that. They probably have lives and don't waste their time playing with Facebook. Do you see the irony in that? You friend or follow somebody because they're doing something interesting with their lives, and they don't waste precious time doing stupid stuff like spending hours on Facebook. Corporation and marketers tell us, hey, it's cool to connect. But behind the scenes, they're only interested in the conversion and monetization of traffic. And listen carefully.
The low self-esteem success chance is the conclusion that you want your prospect to have, which says, well, these guys are smart and I'm retarded. Oh, actually, that's not the exact one, but let's say they have that conclusion A. These guys are smart. I'm retarded. I can't do it. But if I could just do one-tenth as much as they do, then this would definitely be worth it. Right? You ever had that rationalization in your mind? Like, well, I'm over here telling you about doing $10 million and whatever a day, you know, 360 grand in 9 minutes and all that kind of stuff. I mean, you ever think to yourself, well, Jesus, if I could just do like a little bit of that, I would be stoked. Not to say you guys all have low self-esteem, although every single person in the world does, which you should be happy about because you can prey on it like an evil. Never mind. Anyway, so that's what you want, right? You can prey on it like an evil. You can prey on it like an evil. You can prey on it like an evil.
The predator mentality of marketing and how it corrupts our relationships is why Bill Hicks says to marketers, kill yourself.
By the way, if anyone here is in advertising or marketing, kill yourself. Thank you. Just a little thought. I'm just trying to plant seeds. There's no rationalization for what you do, and you are Satan's little helpers, okay? Kill yourself. Seriously. You're the ruiner of all things good.
Most men live lives of quiet desperation and go to their grave with their song still in them. Henry David Thoreau. Facebook is also voyeuristic. Everybody wants to see if so-and-so got fat or what their kids look like. This allows you to look into people's lives, but it never really tells the story of their lives. Behind all the smiles lies a quiet sense of desperation. It may be money issues or relationships or disease or work issues. We all have it. We all have a deeper life that we would share with real friends, but not with your Facebook friends. If you cannot be open with a person, why even let them in your life? Why would you let them look in? We are way too polite as we give up that part of us to people who don't even really care about us. We must keep the sacred from the profane. Since we put ourselves into this petri dish of social voyeurism, we force ourselves to put on a mask. We intentionally mask what we really feel for many reasons. We may not want to upset someone, or we may want to impress somebody. The problem comes when we wear a mask so much that we lose who we really are. This may stifle some desire to do something, or to be who you really want to be. Since we wear this mask, people who we do let into our lives only know the mask. Then you become too afraid to be who you really are, for fear of scaring them off. This ultimately leads to unfulfilling relationships or worse. Now before you Facebook people get all upset, Facebook does have some good qualities. Yes, it is cool to connect with old friends and share pictures. Your Facebook life is reflective of your real life. Most of the people that are on Facebook have a life, and it doesn't consume them. Facebook is not the cause of these problems any more than pencils misspell words. Facebook is just an easy outlet for millions trying to find meaning or connection in their lives. The problem is, this kind of connection is superficial and unfulfilling. What Facebook is to emotional social fulfillment is what porn is to an emotional sexual fulfillment. Nothing beats the real thing. If you really want to connect with people, quit texting and commenting and pick up the phone and talk. Video chat is even better because so much of our communication is nonverbal. We can judge a person's emotions within seconds of seeing them. So much of our communication is lost through this electronic filter. The best way to communicate, of course, is face-to-face. The best conversations I've ever had in my life occurred when I got together to have a drink and just talk. These connections energize us because it is what we are meant to be doing. We are visual, emotional, and spiritual beings wanting to connect on a deeper level with meaning and purpose. If your life does not have meaning or purpose, look at the friends you keep. Facebook acts as a tool towards that purpose. It is a sad substitute for the real thing. Real communication about real issues is hundreds of times more powerful than the non-emotional niceties that pass for communication on Facebook. Do you realize there's a whole generation of humans that thinks this is normal? The criminal elite know that if they take away the meaning of words, it incapacitates our thought. If you cannot speak, you cannot think. If you cannot think, you cannot figure things out. If you cannot figure things out, you will never see that you're a slave. If you cannot see that you're a slave, you'll never rebel. If you cannot rebel, you'll never be free. And if you cannot be free, you'll never fulfill your purpose on earth to be your highest and best self. Until they become conscious, they will never rebel. And until after they have rebelled, they cannot become conscious. George Orwell. How long will it take for a computer algorithm to become your friend? Don't laugh. People think that Bitcoin is real money. Look at your Facebook contacts and tell me that the majority of the connections could not be programmed. Subject A is sad. An algorithm spits out, cheer up, it'll be okay. Or, tell me about it. Or, I'm here for you. Or, I love you. If the contact is that vapid, and this is truly a narcissistic experience, who wouldn't like to have a bunch of yes men as friends? Mental masturbation to distract you from a hole in your life? The more this narcissism persists, the more it turns into psychopathic behavior in the real world. The biggest promoters are the ones making the biggest bucks. All of a sudden, people think psychopathic, narcissistic behavior is the key to success. Look at some of the shows like Jersey Shore or Real Housewives. They are nothing more than the normalization of psychopathic behavior. People figure it's going on all around them and they think that it's the way it's supposed to be. Well, it's not, and we must keep this out of our lives. We have seen many people mistaken the attention and kind words from friends online and throw that against the people in your real life. Your wife isn't doing it for you? Well, you have girls online that think that you're the best thing since sliced bread. Your husband moody? Well, your ex-boyfriend recently divorced and is so supportive. These serve as temptations that we just don't need in our already stressful lives. This bleed into the real life is where the electronic experience gets dangerous. How many times have you been in the room with someone and they're checking their email while they're talking to you? The constant rush of connection has become all too prevalent in our lives. I fear if things don't change soon, we'll become isolated little bits of nothing. First, we became disconnected from nature and never really saw the amazing sight our world has to offer. We hardly look at the stars anymore and see how small we really are. Then the family got ripped apart when the father left home for a job to provide for his family. Then the wife had to enter the workforce to keep up with inflation and the Joneses. Now children are even separated from their friends from this electronic void of never knowing what a true friend is. What chance will they have in life? What kind of future are we building? Instead of seeing how small we are in the real world, we are pushed to us being the center of a narcissistic virtual world. Then there is the burnout experience from all this constant back and forth. Responding to people's comments, likes, and dislikes is tiring. Then you have to think, did I say this right? How will they take this? I can imagine at some point this becomes real work to balance all these quote-unquote friends. Everyone is always looking over your shoulder and all in your business. If anything, wouldn't it get boring? Don't we have anything better to do? One other thought I would like to explore is how many of your friends are because of circumstances or real friends. We are friends with schoolmates, coworkers, families, and neighbors by circumstances. They're in your life and they're agreeable enough to spend time with. For the most part, you never really get to know them, or you really don't want to get to know them. If you're not living with these people, how many would you still pursue in real life? One interesting thing that I found working on this project and consulting with people, I tend to have deeper conversations with the one-on-one calls that I do than most people have in their real lives. I have no time for superficiality and often ask tough questions and challenge people. It instantly breaks through the mask we all wear. It gets to the real issue and the real person asking it. I think once you get beyond the mask, you can become real friends and have deeper relationships. You should not be afraid to try this with your people in your life. You will either have less negative people in your life, or you will have deeper relationships with the ones that you love. I predict that there will come a time when people will quit all this vapid social networking and reestablish a real life. I believe that the crash of the dollar will coincide with this. We will no longer be able to get something for nothing and give up everything real for that nothing. Then we will have a new day where we can get back to something that really matters. A smaller, slower, more local life is in your future. That, of course, is after a massive social upheaval. Those that have the strongest real relationships will be the ones most likely to succeed. Do yourself a favor today. Go into your Facebook account settings and deactivate Facebook. Don't worry, everything will be safe for a couple months. Blow past the creepy Mary and John will miss you pictures and post a link to this video as the reason why you're doing it. See how many people even notice that you're missing. See if someone will try to actually find you in the real world and contact you. If they do, they're probably a real friend and someone you should really get to know better.
Good for you. I really appreciate his comments. It was Adlai Stevenson who said the human race has improved everything except the human race. And that's what he's saying. In our efforts to try to make us happier, we distract ourselves. And we end up right back where we started. Let's go over and say hello to someone who found a way to change her life by slowing it down, taking herself out of an environment that was hectic, frenetic, and putting herself into a complete holistic environment. Nature, trees, workshops, wonderful food, silence, and detoxing. Her name is June. Hi, June.
Hi, Gary. How are you?
Good. June, you came to a couple retreats.
Yes. Yes, I have.
Tell us your experience.
In a word, magical. Or two words, transforming. I cocooned myself in a very toxic environment. And Gary, I've always revered your wisdom. And I thought, why would I ever not want to be in your presence and be in this amazing environment that was described to me? I can't tell you how truly grateful I am that you have offered that experience to the world.
Okay, I want you to focus on something. June, you are you're in the health field. You're a nurse practitioner.
Correct.
Okay, now, you've seen thousands of patients.
Yeah.
Tell me what you observed in people who came to a health retreat.
All right, that is an excellent point, because I am very, very observant. And I just pay attention. Body language is everything. And I would see, and also, coming from an ER perspective, I could see the skin tone, the skin color. I would see the light in their eyes. Coming into the retreat, it was dullness. The shoulders were hooped. Even the people with canes and wheelchairs and walkers, it was as if they were injected with this phenomenal gift of you transforming them and them completely opening and allowing them to believe in you. I saw somebody literally throw a cane away that he was leaning on and walking with for about 15 years. I saw people standing upright. I could see the brightness in their eyes. I could see the joy of just existing. They found the power and goodness to live again, because it's a wonderful world that you can create yourself, and you empower people that way. You offer the most amazing gift to allow somebody like myself to come back home to themselves and truly be authentic on every level possible.
June, you were there at the evening discussions, or I do a lecture every evening, and ask people, would they like to talk about their experiences, and especially when they're exiting on the last day. What were some of the most remarkable transformations that people talked about that you were there to witness?
Actually, they came with certain illnesses, and one of them comes to mind, and he was a very, very non-compliant diabetic who needed his leg to be amputated. And between the greens and the juicing and the detoxing and the amazing care that Lou Antonisi gave him on his leg, you saved his life. I don't even believe you just saved his leg. And this is just one of hundreds of examples that I could share with you. He ended up, I could not even see the gangrene. It was gone. And he was there for 2 weeks. What regular traditional medicine tried to do never would have accomplished what you did.
Well, he came there because the next day he was going in for surgery to have his leg removed.
Oh.
And he didn't want to, so he didn't want to have it removed. So he actually got out of a hospital in Los Angeles, wrapped up his leg, and came. Okay. And he wasn't even on the schedule. We didn't even know who he was. It was just this terrible smell outside. And someone said, there's a guy outside, he smells. And we went out, and I said, you've got gangrene, don't you? And he's dead, and he showed us. And it was just this huge purple dead tissue. Mm-hmm. And then 2 weeks later, it was completely healed.
Completely.
Okay. Well, so I just wanted to thank you for calling in. I appreciate it, June.
My honor. By the way,
Yes. What? Go ahead, please.
I would definitely love to be at this upcoming retreat. I think that it's transforming. And everybody should have that experience, because it's not just a once in a lifetime. You've given me several opportunities, and I'm always and will always be eternally grateful for your wisdom, your brilliance. I've never seen anybody. Well, I'm so mean to go off on a tangent like that.
Let's just let people decide for themselves. Thank you, June.
Sure.
Let's, one more person, let's say hello to Barbara. Barbara is a 40-year practicing nurse. Hi, Barbara.
Hi, how are you, Gary?
How many retreats have you attended?
I think it's over 7.
Why?
Because I continue to see people learning how to heal themselves, people who have taken the knowledge that you offer them, the type of foods, people who are at different levels in their life, either just starting to learn about holistic health, and people who are struggling with life-threatening diseases, the whole gamut. And each time I see different miracles happening.
Give us an idea of a couple of the things you've seen that you have never seen in your regular orthodox practice in hospitals.
Well, the one that always sticks out in my mind is the woman that came in the wheelchair with the oxygen. And how she was able to transform from being wheelchair-bound and oxygen-dependent to gradually walking without the oxygen. And the next thing, she was walking with the personal trainer down the long driveway and out onto the road. And before she left, she was without her oxygen. She did not need the wheelchair. And she went home a different person.
She had end-stage emphysema. Her name was Carol.
Yes,
she's an attorney from California. She only had weeks to live. Today, she's completely healthy. And what other one?
Oh, my goodness, there's so many to choose from. But there was a young girl with MS who had trouble walking. And this is at the last retreat. And she was able to spend the time in terms of her nutrition, in terms of meditation, in terms of journaling and coming in touch with her life and the healthy modalities that were offered there.
And what was the outcome?
She went home. She was walking. I know there, I don't have the exact, but I know she went from having trouble walking to being able to walk extensive periods.
She couldn't raise her leg in the air. She fell over, and at the end, she could raise it for 47 seconds, one leg, with advanced multiple sclerosis. Okay, well, thank you, Barbara. Are we going to see you at the upcoming retreat?
Yes, you will, Gary. I'm looking forward to it.
Good. Let's just take one more. Anthony. Hi, Anthony.
Gary?
Hi.
How are you?
Good. Anthony, you didn't come with an illness. Like this this little audio clip we did before here about Facebook, you came to reconnect with the vitalism of life. And what has been your experience?
Well, I think overall it's been fantastic. Like I'm looking forward to coming to the next retreat. But I've gone to the last, like one week in October and one the previous April, and it was, everything was very positive about the whole thing. I mean, from the staff that was very, I thought, very kind and supportive and just generous, and everyone, you know, from the cook to the people that are helping with the exercises, it was all just such a warm, I think, nurturing environment. And I feel when I'm there, just a sense of, I do feel a connectedness to, like, some kind of human, spiritual, entity, and also just the natural beauty of the place. I just feel very at peace there and relaxed. And I just enjoy walking around the property and just being there and being around people that are, you know, that are definitely, you know, healing. It's apparent around you. And you know, I don't know a lot of, I mean, I do see it, you know, very special things happening there. And I just feel a real connectedness to everything that's going on there.
Have you seen people who transform their lives?
Yes. You know, I was just thinking, you know, listening to Barbara and also to June that, there was definitely a bunch of, you know, I'm not sure exactly what some people were going through, but I did notice, you know, at the end of a week, one person that was particularly elderly that had, I think had some type of dementia and trouble walking was, his mind was clearer after 1 week and he was speaking more clearly and he was remembering things and much more lucid and, you know, engaging and he was, you know, walking better. And there were overweight people that I think had different conditions that were, you know, feeling better elderly people, overweight people, people that I think had conditions that I wasn't really aware of what they were, you know, dealing with, but that definitely seemed a real positive, you know, feeling, you know, after a week that they were, on the road to recovery.
Good. Well, we look forward to seeing you there in April, Anthony.
All right. Thanks so much, Gary. I look forward to it as well. Very much.
Okay. Good. Before we go to Luann and close out this segment, here are some people from last retreat. Let's just play this short clip.
And I have to say that being on this retreat is the best thing that I have done for my life and my kids because I suffer from Crohn's disease. And right before coming here, I was having the symptoms of Crohn's disease were acting up, and the minute that I got here, with the diet that we get, the exercise that we get, I immediately noticed a change in my system. My symptoms calmed down, and I'm also very grateful to Gary being so accessible, also Luann, and has definitely definitely inspired me to change my life, and most importantly for my children as well. I have three children, and once I get back home, we are definitely going to start our new life. Thank you, Gary.
Hello, my name is Jackie. I just completed a week at the Gary Knowles Retreat. I'm excited to talk about my experience. I had a cyst on my hand, and my doctor said the only choice is to have it cut off or live with it. But only 1 week with Gary, my cyst is gone. So thank you so much, Gary Knowles.
Hi, my name is Barton, and I've been here for about a week and had an amazing experience. One of the most significant experiences, having energy work from Gary. And I had nagging pain for a long time, and it's significantly reduced. It's almost not there. Still working on it. Also, my pressure stabilized. I had high blood pressure. Stabilized. Also, I have a nice reset on working out and getting fit. And I also lost, at least yesterday when I checked, at least about 5 pounds. So that's pretty great for less than a week. And it's just an amazing experience to be in nature and to reset your health. Thank you, Gary.
Hi, my name is Ronnie. I am here at the Gary Knowles Health Retreat and having a wonderful time. I came down with really bad insomnia, and last night I slept peacefully for the first time in about 3 months. And my energy level is phenomenal. I was feeling like I needed to take a nap every day between 3 and 5 sometime, and now I'm going straight through till 9, 10 o'clock, still with plenty of energy, and I would highly recommend it for anyone. And as a health practitioner, I think it's a really wonderful thing to have all the insight and knowledge that Gary shares in his lectures, as well as all the healthy opportunities that you have here.
Hello, my name is Madeline, and I've been here at a retreat for 2 weeks, and I came in with a tremendous amount of inflammation in my viscera, in my belly, in my back, and I have no inflammation right now. Inflammation is way, way down. I also came in after three weeks of prednisone, which left me with a face that looked like a chipmunk, and that is completely gone. Rashes have gone away. Joint pain has gone away. A deeper connection to myself, greater inner strength and ability to focus and be, what word would I use here, have more passion for life and my future.
I've learned to acquire a more virtuous cycle of discipline and self-care again. Luann, the nurse, coached my health and attitude and structured my goals. John Q, the trainer, brought my body back to life. I didn't know that I had the power in my body. I had all sorts of conditions and restrictions, and now I can walk where I want to, bike where I want to. Valentina, my favorite chef, nourished my body and my heart. Elaine, the art therapist, stimulated my creativity and spiritual quest. Jan grounded me, and Gary, you made it all possible. I've learned that I've just begun to build myself from the ground up. There's a great deal to be done, a very great deal. And I need to work very, very hard spiritually, mentally, and physically. I'm looking at my level of consciousness and how I'm employing it. I'm learning to push myself beyond my physical and emotional limits. And I know this is a good beginning. And I'm very, very grateful to be alive. Very grateful to you, Gary, for sticking with me and giving me the gift of life.
Those are just a few of the testimonials. I don't diagnose or treat anyone. I simply open doors to opportunity to understand your own vital life energy, your chi, and how to work with it in this environment. Luann Panessi. Luann?
Hello, Gary. Boy, it was great to hear from everybody. That's just terrific. I am filling up, and the first week is pretty much full. I did have a couple of people that moved over to the second week. This is going to take place in April of this year, the second and third week of the month. So if people are interested, I definitely want them to give me a call. My number is 903-881-7008. That's 903-881-7008. And I'll be happy to give you more details about it. And as you heard, there are some people that come down with conditions and they leave with incredible improvements. There are other people that come down just to pull back and relax and regroup and maybe start a whole new chapter in their lives. And so for me as a nurse, to see people transform and leave with a whole new context of how they fit into their world is so refreshing compared to people that just keep adapting down to the medical system and doing what their doctor says and all this other stuff. So I'm really looking forward. We have a great group of people coming down. A lot of new people from your audience, Gary, who've been just tuning in, and they're very excited about coming down and being a part of this group. So.
Well, let's hope the people get off the grid, realize that they cannot live their life over, so why not take time for themselves? That's what's important. Just slow it down. You can always make an excuse to do more for other people, be responsible to the 100th degree, but where are you giving yourself unconditional love, time, space to do your own inner journey? And this is the place to do it, with a support team that's just excellent, 20 staff, all there, because they want to see the joy of people in their road to transformation. Thank you, Luann. We look forward to people joining us in April.
Okay.
Now, I'd like to welcome all of you who are just coming on board. What I want to do now is I want to play an audio clip from Dr. who was at the in the film, a very important part of the film, Deadly Deception. She is Dr. Suzanne Humphreys, and she's board-certified nephrology, which is kidney disease, And now people who are speaking out, no matter how articulate, accurate, documented, supported, they're being attacked by the pharmaceutical industry using very dirty tricks. This just happened to her just 2 days ago. Once it was known that this webinar was going to happen to scare people out.
And so what I'd like to do now is read you the email. So it says, I'm gonna effing murder you, you stupid effing C word. I'm just letting you know. Just to let you know that when it happens, you were effing warned, bitch. You're always putting your location out there, so it's real effing easy to get you. I have a nice, beautiful desert eagle. That's a very big 5-pound handgun, if you don't know. That's going to be used on you, yes. So keep thinking all your health shit is going to help you, because guess what, C-word? It's not going to help you live another effing day. I'm going to step right out of the pedestrians on the street and blast you right in the effing chest. Not the head, because I want you to squeal, bitch. I'm going to make you effing squeal and shake on the ground, flailing, bleeding out. I'm going to kill as many of you Fs as I can before I go down. You're done, bitch. Do you understand me? I've thought about how to do it for a while, and I have it pretty much down. I want to pull you off the road and torture you to death, but it's just too effing hard to pull off. Another idea I had is when you're doing one of your live things, I want to walk right to the door and shoot you live on camera so everyone sees you effing begging C-word. You're going to effing squeal so hard because I'm going to hit you in the chest, then the legs, bitch, to make you suffer before I finish you. I want everyone to see how you go. I effing promise you I'm coming, bitch. I just got to decide how I want to do it. Maybe when you're giving one of your dumbass talks, I'll go sit in the audience towards the back and do it. But it's not easy to kill all your dumb C-word friends that way. No, it's pretty obvious to me that I got to come to your effing autism center and shoot you right through the effing door when you're on camera. That's how I'm going to do it. I'm going to kill every single one of you effers. Do you understand me? I'm effing coming for you, so be ready for it. I don't want to see any shock on your effing face when I'm at the door. I'm effing shoot right through that door with a shotgun, C-word. I'll kill every single person in that house, and then I'm going to torture you good. I'm going to make you bleed till there's nothing left of you, then finish you. I just need to get a few things in order before I do it, but I've been wanting for a long time.
All right, now, for those of you who are not social activists, for those of you who have not understood what it means to be in the front line of any group that is fighting on behalf of an important ideal, in this case, freedom of choice. I don't tell people to get vaccinated or not to get vaccinated. That's their choice. But right now in America, they're passing laws and moving in different states. California was the first. Louisiana already had excluded exemptions, so that you'll have no choice. Your child will have to be vaccinated, and then you at work will have to be vaccinated. They're going for the whole population because it's a $100 billion a year profit center for the pharmaceutical industry with no liability, no downside. So it exceeds all their other drugs when it comes to how much net profit they make. So along comes a board-certified physician. She gets interested in the topic. She spends probably 15,000 to 20,000 hours reading every study there is and comes to the conclusion that vaccine science is junk science. It's fake science. And the information that the media gives us is fake information. It's not real. It's not based upon what the real data show. And now she is banned from Australia. Another person in the film, for example, Dr. Brian Hooker, told me that he has been attacked, and one of his peer review articles was retracted. Was there something wrong with the article? No. It was all stupid, he said, because they said, well, we retracted your article after it was known that he was going to be in this film because you didn't acknowledge that you sat on a board of an autism foundation. Well, first of all, he says, that article was accepted and published prior to me going on a free onto an advisory board for autism. So one had nothing to do with the other. They'll use any pretense or pretext to hurt someone and then say, oh, well, he had to have an article retracted and use that against him. There are thousands of trolls working for the pharmaceutical industry, and their major attack is now on vaccines. And why? It's simple. If Deadly Deception, my new documentary, is able to be seen by a lot of people, and we're putting it up on progressiveradionetwork.com, PRN.FM, for you to see, and we're going to try to get it up there today, then you may not choose to vaccinate or vaccinate with all the different vaccines because you'll have new information. We also are posting and have posted a new article that really takes on the whole politics and profits behind the scenes. And it's called, it's about vaccines and the deep state. So you can read it up there and download it. It's fully referenced. So we could be causing them billions of dollars. So they've unleashed all of their trolls, their hitmen, their scientists for hire. And so this is just one example, threatening to kill, mutilate a doctor who appears in the film, banning her from a country. Another person in the film said he was banned from going to Australia. Another person, when he was leaving Australia, another person's in the film, a lawyer, they detained him at the airport and said, when he finally asked, why am I being detained? Well, because you're one of those people that question vaccines, and that's considered a national security risk to us. And so he finally got out of the airport after a whole day. That's the kind of police state that we're looking at today. So what you can expect, and I mentioned this just a few weeks ago in my radio program, you can expect every possible attack, every kind of slander and libel, every kind of lie and distortion that they're going to throw at everyone in the film, but especially me. They want to kill the messenger so that you don't hear the message. And they do that by slander, libel, and demonization. And they have the media behind them. 100% of the media is on their side. The media will do exactly what they want and have. They have the scientific community on their side. They have the medical community on their side. They have the entire American Congress and the president. They have everyone on their side. So then you think, well, why would you be so stupid as to think you could make a difference? Because every single change that's ever occurred in history has occurred when one person gets an idea and believes that its time has come. And then other people who become aware of that idea can support it. Now, whether that's a good idea or a bad idea, only history will tell. But being an activist my entire life, I'm used to these kind of attacks. I'm used to the character assassination. I'm used to the lies, Wikipedia, all lies. I'm used to this. But for other people, they're not. But to a person, everyone who's being attacked for appearing in the film and telling the truth, these are people with strong characters. They're not going to stop. As Susan Humphrey said, I'm going to protect the children as best I can by informing their parents about the dangers of vaccines. And so all you do when you do these stupid things is you get people to be even more focused and concentrated in their efforts. So it will not work. They can demonize us. They can cause us to be shunned by so many people because the people won't look for the truth. They won't look for the other side. They'll believe the media, and you never want to believe the media. My God, the media is they're such whores. They are so degenerate. They're just terrible human beings. Just forget the idea that, well, they'll self-censor. No, they're bad people because the consequences of them supporting the official views end up with 20 million dead since World War II in our interventions, all of which the media was supporting from Vietnam. Only later did they even question the ethics of doing these things. And in any case, I want just to hear just one example of what it's like to be a part of a social movement to help protect the American public, especially our most vulnerable, our children, and how they attack. And that's just the beginning of it. It'll get worse. I'm Gary Null. Thank you all for listening. Look forward to sharing more tomorrow. Have a nice day. So I'd like to know.
since our voyage of love began.